this whole thing, especially since we have another meeting. So, thank you for coming to the panel of Ricky Simons. I'm going to do what I do for a lot of my panels and just read the first graph of your Wikipedia page, because I always find that the most entertaining, especially when some of the things are wrong and they go, no, no, that's not it at all. I'm not going to read all of it, but Ricky Simons is an American voice actor, writer, graphic novelist, and artist, best known as the voice of, I'm hoping I'll say this right, Gur. I like that even better. In the Nickelodeon animated series Invader Zim, you can tell it's like a generation beyond me. I'm a little too old for that. Don't ever get old. Simons also co-created and wrote Robotech Clone series, comic series. In 2017, he voiced his first non-Invader Zim role as the Red Troblin and some incidental Cardassian characters in the Cartoon Network series.
Oh, wow, they got it updated from
our Troblins. Yeah, this was updated about a month ago. Wow. You have a dedicated fan. I was going to ask if it was you. Did you update your own?
No.
The Cartoon Network series Mighty Magisword Swords. So, ladies and gentlemen,
funny thing about my Wikipedia page is it deleted six times, and every time somebody adds it back, and then I go and I read the discussion, and it's always this argument between different devs who don't agree whether or not I account for anything, like because there's guys who've never heard of the show, or they just don't care, or they think it's because I'm only known for one thing that I shouldn't be on there. No, but he's
boys
and girls. So, yeah. So I'm surprised to see this back again, because last time I checked, I had no Wikipedia page.
Well, you're there now.
Nice.
I was going to say, it's even got your full name. I mean, that's how big time you are now.
Oh, Rosemary. Yeah.
So you've been both voice, you've done art. How did you get into this? What was your path into Invader Zim? What do you enjoy better more? Do you like doing the art? Do you like doing the voice?
Well, my favorite thing is writing. My favorite thing is writing, and then acting, and then art. I'm not known for my writing yet. So the acting is what I'm mostly known for. But I started in the 1990s doing background acting in movies. And I'm also a fashion journalist along with my wife, who was a photo stylist. We would go around in LA and interview fashion designers and musicians and performance artists, that sort of thing. And then I got into background acting in the middle of all that. And then I got from there, we were trying to create a children's book, but somehow ended up in comics. And then we ended up making a Robotech series for this publisher based in Indiana that had acquired the rights. And then later on, right in 95, I met Jonan Vasquez, the creator of Invader Zim, and we became friends. And then he asked me to color his show, and then he asked me to actually come in and audition for Gurr, because he said I sounded like him in his mind. So it was sort of like he couldn't find anybody anyways. He said, come in for the audition, you couldn't screw it up any more than anyone else.
High praise right there.
Yes, that's the way he is. Most of the actors who came in to audition for Gurr were very professional people. And since I had only done background acting, it wasn't considered professional. So that's why he had that sort of like, I need somebody who's sloppy and terrible. Most people came in with it also did sort of like a goofy voice, or like, ooh, hey kids, that sort of thing. So you imagine Gurr, doing that, doom, 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 woohoo, that sort of thing, which made him want to die. And I was living with Jonan for about 20 days, working on a book of this when all that stuff was happening. So that was a special time of, don't ever live with Jonan Vasquez. But he's fine, though. He's good. Well, it was always pitch black at his house. I had to walk around in the daytime with the mag light. But otherwise, it's fine. I think he likes daylight now.
He goes for walks. So that was so. Gurr was really your first character, your first voice.
Yes.
So what did you do to approach that? How did you take, you know, what, how did you create Gurr?
According to Jonan, Gurr is just me. So I didn't really have that stretch very hard with it. I have a way of doing different kinds of inflections that I guess he picked up on. Well, I'm going, hey, what's that? You know, things like that. And I guess he really picked up on that. But I remember one time he really took notice. We were in West Hollywood, and somebody came up to solicit something to me. We were standing on a street corner, and this guy came up, and he was trying to get me to buy something. And I listened to this guy's speech, and all I said was, and then I walked away. And he was laughing so hard after that. It was after that that he started talking about me coming in for an audition.
Well, so I'm curious, is it, when you're known for a character, is it hard for you to make sure that you're not repeating that character, especially when the character is kind of you?
Yeah, it is a little hard for that. Although, the other character I did on Invader Zim is Bloaty the Pig.
And he sounds like this!
You know, he's horrible. He's like, everything you shouldn't do as a voice actor. He's just destroyed.
He says, look at Bloaty!
Jonan loves that voice. That's the one that, when people call me in to do stuff, it's usually that voice that they want. Because they're so afraid of me sounding like Gurr, that they don't usually call me in for that. So I usually get horrible monster roles. That's why I was surprised when the first thing I did for Mighty Magiswords was a character called Red Trollblin. Who's this giant red troll, and he has this like server accent, like this, hey buddy, you know, that sort of thing. So that was nice. I got to do some not monster with that show. Well, I've been doing a lot of monsters since then for the show. I think it was a goat a couple weeks ago.
So are you creating the characters, or are they directing you, hey, I want a surfer voice, or are they giving you, or are you just taking what you look
at? I'd definitely be given direction. Kyle Carroza, the creator of that show, he actually creates an animatic first, where he acts out all the parts in a very sort of like choppy, stilted animation that's taken from the storyboards that they redraw. And that's because Kyle is also one of the main voice actors in the show, so that way he doesn't have to direct us while he's acting. So we watch clips of the animatic, we hear what he wants from us, and then we try to do that. The sessions go by really quickly. Like when I do Mighty Magiswords, I'll be scheduled to do like a episode that takes from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m., but we're out in an hour. It's a very, very fast process. With Zim, I'll be scheduled for 4 hours, and we'll go all the way to the 4 hours, and we're still not done. Because Jonan's process is there's nothing but the script. There's no animatic or anything. And he wants to create the process of what the actors are going to give him with the actors. So we'll take his direction, and then we'll give him three versions of it. And then suddenly he likes something in the other version. We'll either use all three versions, so then your character is repeating themselves and they sound schizophrenic, or he just goes with your worst version. He loves screw-ups. He just loves how that sounds. It's more real to him. So yeah, it's different with every casting director and creator you work with. They all have their style.
And do you do it with full casts or like everybody in the room?
Yeah, like with Magiswords, it's full cast and nobody's wearing headphones, which is unusual.
So almost like a table read.
Yeah, it's like a table read. We're just standing there or sitting. And just doing our part in the microphone. In fact, I think they even just don't even bother cutting out some of the mess ups that you hear in between. So it's very, but Magiswords is a very fast show. Whereas Zim, we record with the main, it was all for the main character. characters together. We'll record all four of us together. But all the other actors either come in separately another time or are recorded in a special isolation booth. And a lot of times when I'm with Richard Horvitz, who's Zim, he'll be in an isolation booth also because our characters talk so closely together. And they also have processing to GURP. They put a layer of like a robot tin sound in, so they can't get that on, they can't splash that up on Zim. So they usually have us acting together, but there's a glass between us.
Well, do you guys have questions? I know you gotta have questions. Go for it.
What's it like coming back to Invader Zim, because there's a new special coming out, and how like a lot of old cartoons are just making a comeback, like Rocko's Modern World and Hey Arnold?
Yeah. It's great. We're doing a TV movie of Invader Zim. I've already recorded most of it. I think I have one more recording session to do, and then the last of GURP's new lines will be finished. But yeah, the last time I did GURP for Jonin for the show was 15 years ago. I've done video games with GURP since then, but the video games, it's weird that they even asked me to come in to do them because they just have to do the same lines that were in the show. So you can just take those from the, I don't know why you're having me do this again, but it's like GURP just says the same thing in those games. And those are games where like GURP teams up like SpongeBob, and they're called Summer Splash Specials. Then there's one baseball game where GURP is in the stands yelling at baseball players or something. and the people playing baseball are like, you know, Squidward and all those guys. So I did those. That was like the last time I've done anything for GURP until this movie came along. So I love that we're doing this again. And especially the script is really, really funny. It's written by Jonin, so and he's directing the cast. Yes.
Do you think what this new visual of you would think I'll spot like a TV show and you know a whole new thing season of Invader Zim?
I would love that. If we did, I would absolutely love that. It's all up to Jonin's moods. He likes to do new things all the time, brand new things all the time. So part of me thinks the only reason why he's doing this movie is because Nickelodeon built a new building.
Oh, wow.
And so he was like, oh, I don't have to go back to the old building? Okay, this will be new. So.
Do you think there's an could work as an adult show instead of a kid's show, like, kind of like Rick and Morty style, or like something like that? Or do you think it's like, as a kid's show?
I don't know if that would work out that way, because I mean obviously with Jonin's style of humor you could do that sort of thing very easily. I don't know if it would function well with so overtly like that with Invader Zim, because there's already a certain way of handling violence and humor and all that sort of stuff that has always been inherently different than what you see with Rick and Morty. It's a dark show like Rick and Morty. It's a sardonic show. The humor is definitely dark like that show, but because we put it on Nickelodeon, we never went that direction. Rick and Morty wasn't always supposed to be, you know, above a certain age level, but given that, what we're doing now in the new movie there are things in it that we couldn't have done 15 years ago. They're not like, you know, bloody explosive and stuff, but there's things the characters can now say, not swears or anything, but there's just things that they can say that we weren't allowed to say before. That is really funny. I really like how there feels like there's a new kind of freedom to the show, but it still feels like the old show.
Kind of like Black Widow.
Well, that was when John Kay got all his rights back, and he just did it the way he wanted, completely unrestrained. I don't know. know if Jonan would go that crazy way John Kay did if he was completely unrestrained. I think he would do certainly some things that, I think he would make it more obvious. I think Jonan would just make it more obvious that certain characters get killed in the scenes instead of just hearing an explosion. In the original Zim, if you wanted to, like, that person's dead now. The Gurr gets dropped off after partying all night with some teenage girls at a disco or something. And then you see them, like, drop him off, and they're like, they wave, and the second they drive away, he asks the sound guy to add an explosion and a car crash. Like, they're dead now. He's like, I have to secretly kill somebody all the time. There has to be some sort of dark conclusion to all the characters.
And could you tell us how and why did the show about cats not good work?
It was very expensive. It was $500,000 per episode. And after a while, Nickelodeon noticed.
SpongeBob, right?
Well, SpongeBob was a big thing. Obviously, that represented exactly what they wanted. And it was 2001 when it came out. A very bad time for a show like that to come out. 9/11 happened while we were making the show. So it had gone from, hey, let's do a dark and sardonic show, to something, ooh, maybe it's not the right mood right now. In fact, we had an episode where Zim and Gurr go around selling candy door to door, and because Zim wants to sell this candy because he thinks it will give him power. I can't remember why, but he goes around putting a virtual reality headset on anybody who doesn't buy the candy to show them the nightmare world this world will become if he doesn't buy their candy.
Yeah, that was
and the scene that these people get shown originally, what their world will become, shows New York City on fire. And this was like just before 9/11 happened that we animated this sequence, and they're like, no, you can't show New York on fire, oh my god. And actually Jonan was fine with that because he didn't want for it to be obvious that Zim existed in the same universe as our Earth. He wanted it to be a country that occupies the American continent, but it isn't exactly America. There's something wrong with that country, whatever it is. The sky is red. It looks like something terrible has happened in that world. So Zim's Dib's Earth is like an alternate, really badly affected Earth in some way. So he was kind of glad that they said, don't make it New York City. So instead, what we animated was even worse. It was these mutant demons went around with pitchforks, grabbing people, stabbing people, and throwing them in cages. Hunting them down and throwing them in cages. Yeah. They were like, okay, yeah, that's fine. It's better than New York on fire.
Oh, wow.
But when the episode aired, they didn't edit it right, and they showed the New York on fire on TV.
Oh, wow.
So the DVD now has the corrected version with the pitchfork guys. But the what showed on TV originally was accidentally the one they weren't supposed to show. So I don't think it had any response. I don't think anybody, like it was one of those things where the executives get really concerned about things, and usually there was no backlash for it. A lot of people think the show was canceled because of backlash from parents, but we never really got much. I think kids just weren't allowed to watch it sometimes. There was somebody came by my table yesterday and said that they weren't allowed to watch Invader Zim because there was an episode where a kid got his eyes pulled out. But he said he would watch that episode whenever his mom wasn't around anyways. she was gone, he would find Zim and he would watch it. But the funny thing about the episode about the kid that gets his eyes pulled out, but that episode was approved, and we show basically Zim wants to replace this kid's eyes with robot eyes that make him see another reality so that he'll stop bothering Zim. He's Zim's best friend. So these eyes will make him see a squirrel as Zim, and he'll want to go play with the squirrel instead. But the scene where he tears out the kid's eyes, these robot arms come out of Zim's backpack, and then they lunge for the kid, and then it flips the scene, so you see the whole thing happen in shadow. So you see the robot arm, the shadow of the robot arms come down on the wall, and the kid screaming, and pop out the eyes, and then replace it with the other eyes. And when the executives saw that scene, they brought Jonah into a meeting. It's like, this is, you know, I know we approved this, but this is a lot scarier than we thought it was going to be. It looks pretty horrifying. I mean, you tear out a kid's eyes, and Jonah just said, yeah, but we give him better eyes. And they're like, oh, yeah, okay.
Was the show, you were talking about kind of the sardonic nature of the story. Who are you creating the show for? Was it for kids? Even, I mean, it was on Nickelodeon, or were you trying to kind of do it?
Jonah makes all things for himself. He looks at, in a sense, he is making it for kids, but he's making it for himself as he remembers himself as a kid. Because Jonah was a kid who watched horror movies and laughed at people getting bludgeoned to death and exploding on. Like, one of his favorite movies is this, I can't remember the name of it, but there's this girl who's a robot, and she throws a basketball at this old woman's head, and then it immediately cuts. Like, you can tell when the scene cuts from a real woman's, old woman screaming, to the dummy whose head is full of blood, and the basketball hits this fake woman's head and explodes. There's no reason that any basketball should be able to make anybody's head explode, but that's the kind of stuff he watched when he was a kid. Plus, another one that we both remembered, there was a movie called The Prophecy. It was about a giant killer bear. Came out in 78, 81, something like that. And in the trailer, and in the movie, there's a scene where the bear attacks. It's a big mutant bear. This is the monster. And it attacks these people who are sleeping in sleeping bags around a campfire. And the scene is supposed to be horrifying, but what they filmed were these people trying to run away from the killer bear in their sleeping bags. So they're hopping. it's such a stupid scene. It's supposed to be horrifying. So that's the kind of stuff he laughed at when he was a kid, and like a really little kid, he would watch this stuff. So when people ask, you know, are you making this for children? In a sense, yes, but children that the kind of child he was. That's why he doesn't, he disagrees a lot with executives when they're like, no, this is what kids want to see. He's like,
Well, for the record, I just googled girl throws basketball, head explodes, and it comes up with Deadly Friend. So
Deadly
it's on
Friend.
YouTube.
Yes, Deadly Friend. That's the movie.
1986, yeah. Deadly Friend.
Look up Deadly Friend. This girl gets replaced with a robot.
As Elvira screams in horror, Samantha kills her by throwing a basketball she stole from Tom at her head with extreme strength.
Yeah.
There you go.
And it the wall cracks behind her when she hits the back of the wall. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
And you can tell it's a fake. You can tell it's like a stage set too, because the wall bounces.
The slow connections, I mean, it'll work straight away, but.
Do you think it would last longer if it was a Cartoon Network?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah,
that's the sound effect.
You'll be tweeting that all later, Nick.
It's the old lady from Throw Mama Off from the Train. Yeah, there it goes, yeah.
Y'all have to look it up yourself. That's like Evil Dead.
It's like there's no reason. Like, it's like, is there pressure in her head? Why does her head explode like that? It's just a basketball. It's like, it's not a... I mean, it'd be like a rail gun fired from orbit to make that happen. what was the question?
Do you think it would have been canceled if it was on Cartoon Network? And do you think the show goes better at Cartoon Network than
yes and no. I mean, Cartoon Network.
Then there's Zim. I mean, there's Zim. Yeah, really Andy. That was kind of like Cartoon Network.
Yeah. But the Nickelodeon, both networks are really great because they both focus on creator content. they both have their pluses and minuses. Nickelodeon usually throws in larger budgets, which is one of the reasons why he went with Nickelodeon. They just said that we're going to have a huge budget, which later turned out to be something that was more of a liability. But I think now Jonan has figured out how to do the same kind of thing for half the budget that we used to. But one of the reasons why it cost so much is because we were the first digital show on Nickelodeon. Everything was hand-painted before that. And Nickelodeon, with Zim, we painted with computers. And I was also a background painter still on the show. I painted 700 backgrounds on it. I'm not painting the new one. He's got a whole new crew of people for the new one. Somebody's doing voice acting. But I like the way both studios work one way or the other. They both have their advantages in one way or another. But I think that shows have a better chance of surviving on Cartoon Network a little more than Nickelodeon. I think there's a higher competition on Nickelodeon to try and... Nickelodeon's a little bit like Disney, although Disney is really difficult. Nickelodeon is... Like, Nickelodeon looks for shows that represent Nickelodeon. Will become the next SpongeBob. That is their driving force. And then everything sort of is supposed to swirl around that one main show that is their main brand identity. Whereas Cartoon Network is, I think, let's do as many shows as we can, and that's who we are. We have all these shows. So it's just different with both of them. But I think because of that, there's a better chance shows will stay on Cartoon Network a little bit longer than they do on Nickelodeon, because I don't think it's still really tough competition, and it's really still high stakes, but I don't think, it doesn't, like when I go over there, it doesn't feel as high stakes as Nickelodeon. It feels slightly more relaxed. Although Nickelodeon just built this new building, and I think they're trying to feel a little more groovy, a little more relaxed, with this new building.
And, well, ever since Adventure Time, or even Adventure Show came out, everybody's trying to adopt that kind of style of there's a term for that kind of style, but
like a house style.
Well, yeah, like house style. I guess like you say, every other studio's trying to copy that. You got Star Wars, people, and Disney XD.
Well, it's mostly because all those creators are friends. The people that work on Star, and the people that work on OKKO, and Adventure Time, and Mighty Magisaurs, they all know each other, and I've been to their parties, they're all there. They're huge parties, and it's a bunch of animators drawing. And it's just a big community. So then they swap, artists from team to team, so you end up with sort of a house style, and that even sort of flows from Cartoon Network over into Titmouse, which is a studio that does most of the animation now for the industry. It's strange because you'll go to Titmouse and like on one side of the building, Disney has hired out all the animators on this side, and they're not supposed to really. They can hang out with the people over on the other side who are doing some stuff for other studios like DreamWorks, but they're not really supposed to talk about what they're working on, but it's all one big studio. So it's just the way things work now. It's like every, like Nickelodeon, if you're working at Nickelodeon and Cartoon Network, you're probably going to be there as an employee. You're probably going to have employee benefits and that sort of thing. But if you're working for a lot of other studios, like even Titmouse and stuff, you're a contractor. You don't have any benefits. You're probably in the union, but you're in the union as a contractor. It's just the way that things have changed now. The studio, it's really only about three or four studios, I think, now that actually hire employees instead of having them as contractors these days. Which is weird, though, because even when they have you in as a contractor, they have you come in and work as an employee. You have a desk, and it's like, shouldn't you just be at home if you're a contractor? But that's the way things are now.
How do you think animation has evolved from there to now? Comedy Lost, like you said earlier, saying that there's something you couldn't do 15 years ago, and now you can't. Like, how has that evolved? Do you think it's more mature now? Do you think the whole internet thing?
Well, basically, Invader Zim set a standard 15 years ago that a lot of the shows that you see from Rebecca Sugar's show, what's the name of it? Everybody's got crystals.
Steven Universe.
Steven Universe. Steven Universe. Adventure Time. Most of the shows that are out there are now influenced by Invader Zim because of all those creators. Who now have their own shows, they were about 13, 12 years old when Invader Zim came out, and now they're all adults, and they all went to CalArts or other art schools, and they got animation degrees, and then they went to Cartoon Network, and they got shows. And the fact that Invader Zim never went away, it's still sort of beloved, I think that stayed sort of like something that people looked at and we went like, oh, well, they were able to do that back then, why don't we just do that now? And I don't think they get questioned as much about it as we did then and now, so the standard is now a little more loose than it used to be. They still have standards and practices, and you know, they'll say, no, don't do that, you can't do that, do not throw the baby out the window, you know, that sort of thing, because people, it's mostly because they're so worried about imitatable behavior. That's the one they don't like the most. But other stuff that isn't obviously imitatable behavior, you're able to get away with a little bit more than you used to.
Yeah. Sometimes I see shows like that, like, kind of borderline, like, the gross humor.
And plus you can say things in animation now that you couldn't used to. You couldn't used to be able to say, I'm going to kill him. That guy's going to kill me. We're going to get killed. And even on Zim, we couldn't say that. We'd have to say, we're going to be destroyed. I'm going to destroy you. Somehow being destroyed is less violent than being killed. I guess it's less final. I don't know. It sounds more like an object, I guess, being harmed than a person. But nowadays, a lot of shows, a character's will say something like, oh my god, I'm going to, or oh my gosh, I'm going to die, or something like that. Which we would never be able to say, I'm going to die on Invader Zim. Like, we couldn't even have, we had an episode where FBI agents burst in through a door with guns, and we got a note back saying, no, they can't have guns. Like, but they're the FBI. They're bursting in through a door, all cop, you know, fashion. Like, no, they can't have guns. Replace the guns with something else. So we replaced them with, bananas. And they're like, okay.
So we're pretty close to out of time, but before you go, I wanted to, you mentioned earlier on your writing and such like that, so you want to talk a little bit about that, what you're doing, and where people can find more information about you, meet you?
I also, all these years, been working on different comic projects with my wife, Tavisha. We did a series of Tokyo Pop called Shutterbox. It was 5 volumes. 1,200 pages of comic. Shutterbox is a story of a girl who, when she dreams, she goes to an afterlife called Meridia, where there's a school for muses, and she becomes a living exchange student at this school for muses. So that was a series we did. It sold pretty good. It really did well. We have another series we did called Super Information Hijinks, which is what I was working on when I met Jonan back in the 90s. And that is a series, it was set in the far future of 2012. And it was about a young man named Colin Meeks who had a cat named Catrice. And there was a virtual internet system that people used in 2012. And one night, his cat Catrice sleeps under the virtual reality helmet, and she thinks she's human online, and she just basically wrecks things for him wherever he goes. So that's a series that we recently brought back as a Kickstarter project, which we still need to finish. And I've been writing novels. I wrote a novel called Hitherto a Lion, which was about a biomechanical lion that destroys demons at the end of the universe. It's a space opera. Thought it turned out pretty good. I just finished writing a novel that took me 10 years to finish. So I'll be finding a publisher for that soon. That one's called The Ersatz Sophisticates. It's about a bunch of surrealists. So that's what I do when I'm not acting or painting or drawing. I spend a lot of time in cafes just writing. That's funny.
Cool. Well, thank you all for coming. And where can they find you on this floor? Or you're upstairs?
Second story. Yeah, that balcony.
The fun deck.
Yeah, fun deck.
That's what they're
very fun up there.
The fun deck.
Come by the fun deck. Although I think I already saw you there. I think I saw Pickle Rick go by.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah,
Pickle Rick. Good morning.
Ricky, thank you very much. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.